Guys, I can't believe that we are already halfway through the cinematic movie year, which means it is time for me to break down what are my top 10 favorite movies I've seen this year so far. And in a separate video, I will break down what are the worst movies I've seen this year so far. Even though we're only 6 months into the year, there have been a shit ton of movies that I have seen. We're gonna start at my number 10 and work my way up to number one. Before we kick off the number 10 spot, I just have one honorable mention, and that is Promising Young Woman. Now, the reason this movie is an honorable mention is because technically, this movie was released in 2020. That's right, it was a Christmas release, and it didn't release to PVOD until early 2021. Promising Young Woman would have been one of my top favorite films of 2020, but I didn't see it in 2020, so it didn't make that list. And now we're in 2021, and I feel bad that the movie literally fell in limbo. It is such a fantastically compelling thrill ride of a movie. It is so incredibly juicy. And so I feel like it's only fair that I just list it as an honorable mention. Please go see Promising Young Woman. It is a sensational film, and Carey Mulligan gives arguably the best performance of her career so far. But now let's kick off my official top 10 favorite films of 2021 so far. And in my number 10 spot, we have The Father. This is one of my favorites among the Oscar-nominated, Oscar-buzzy movies. And Anthony Hopkins gives an amazing, amazing performance. This movie is incredibly sad. It is very, very heartbreaking in tackling the very, very tough subject matter of an elderly man well into his struggle with dementia. The structure of the movie itself is incredibly engaging and inventive because it's all from the perspective of Anthony Hopkins's character who is struggling with dementia, and you are basically seeing what he's seeing and what it would be like to be in that tragic state of mind. And even though it may not be a very happy film to revisit, it definitely is a very powerful film. It's a very masterful film, even in terms of performance alone. It is one of those movies to where I do recommend everyone see it just to see Anthony Hopkins give what could arguably be maybe his best performance of his entire career. In my number 9 spot, we have I Care a Lot. Now, this was a very polarizing movie. You either loved it or hated it, and I very much enjoyed it. I think it's very, very fun to watch movies where the main character is portrayed to be a pretty god-awful person, but if played to the point of being so entertaining and so juicy and becoming a person that you kind of love to hate, then it's fun to get on board with them. And Rosamund Pike did a fantastic job in this lead performance. I understand why this movie is gonna piss off some people. She plays a pretty fucking despicable person, but the movie is very well paced, it's very entertaining, and the characters are incredibly charismatic. They are devious. I Care a Lot is essentially about pretty horrible, despicable people that take advantage of elderly people who may not be, physically, mentally, emotionally stable. Granted, this movie is played for entertainment. It's not made to praise people like this. Rosamund Pike gave a powerhouse performance, a very fun, charismatic performance, and she does play a fucking asshole that you hate, but you kind of can't stop looking at her. You can't stop watching her. You want to see what they're going to do next, but you also kind of know that karma is a bitch, and you kind of hope that karma does get this person back. And my number 8 spot is Malcolm and Marie, which I was a little bit surprised that this movie didn't get more award recognition as it did. I thought that John David Washington and Zendaya gave award caliber performances. It is a very contained film. It's just them on screen, and it's basically about a very dysfunctional couple fighting throughout the entire movie. And when you have a movie like that, you need to have the right actors to keep you engaged and keep you interested, because who wants to go into a movie that is about a very toxic, dysfunctional couple just fighting for nearly 2 hours? If you've ever been in a fight with someone that you love, or you've been in a dysfunctional relationship, you will be able to take away something from it. And that didn't make the movie painful to watch, it made it relatable. And because the performances were so great by John David Washington and Zendaya, that's what made the movie worth watching and getting through. In my number 7 spot, we have Raya and the Last Dragon. Now, this was a visually stunning, epic animated Disney film that gives one of the best final acts in a Disney animated movie that we've seen in the last 10 years. I did have some qualms with a little bit of the humor being a bit too childish for my own taste. However, I feel like the world building, the drama, the layers given to the main villain antagonists, This movie really reached higher levels when it came to Disney animated storytelling. Disney doesn't really go very dark anymore, and I felt like this movie did go dark and especially exceeded my expectations leading into the final act. In my number six spot, we have Luca by Pixar. Now, this movie is getting a couple mixed reactions from people. Some people claiming that it's definitely among some of the lower tier of Pixar films and not up there with the greats. And to that point, I do agree. Like, this isn't an epic movie. This isn't a Finding Nemo. It's not a Monsters, Inc. It's not a Toy Story. However, this movie reminded me of some of the more simpler, scenic, and charming Hayao Miyazaki films from Studio Ghibli. Yes, this movie is not a huge adventure, but what really pulled at me was the friendship or relationship between the two main characters in this film. It did make me cry, and I loved just being in this world with them, being on this little adventure, and even though it does feel smaller and it may not be the most innovative of all Pixar films, I did pick up on some potential LGBTQ undertones, whether or not Pixar was intending for that, but I felt like there was a deeper emotional connection that pulled me into this friendship that made this film stand out for me. It did nail that ending in a way that I was not expecting, that did feel like the level of Pixar greats up there, the final act specifically. In my number five spot, we have A Quiet Place Part 2. Now, this was a very engaging and thrilling sequel to A Quiet Place, but I don't think it is as good as A Quiet Place. But this does feel like a very competent, very well-structured second act in this series that does call for a third act, but even if we don't get it, I do feel like this second act was strong. I feel like the performances specifically from Millicent Simmons was really, really phenomenal. I felt like it did shift the focus from the parents in the first one to more of the kids in this one, which felt very appropriate. John Krasinski is such a talented director. This movie had its thrills, much like the first one, and it did have heart, and you do care about these characters, and it was great to be back in this world. It's not as good as the first one, in my humble opinion, but it is a really, really good film. In my number four spot, we have The Mauritanian, which sadly went almost completely unnoticed during awards season, which I thought was criminal. I couldn't believe how much this movie emotionally got to me, how much it resonated with me. The pacing was fantastic. The cast is phenomenal. The true story in which it's based off of was history that I personally was so ignorant of that I'm ashamed that I did not know more about it. It was very enlightening, it was insightful, but it also made me angry and get very riled up by the end of it. But this movie is hopeful, it's very poignant, it's very timely, and it does tell a very, very disheartening but very true story about our modern history of horrible things that have happened just within the last 20 years. In my number three spot, we have In the Heights. Now, this musical has really, really, upon processing it more, upon sitting on it more, has only gotten better and better for me. I've been listening to the soundtrack, but I thought that it was just a very, very strong movie musical in and of itself. Because so many movie musicals can be incredibly campy, they can be incredibly dumb or cheesy, or just don't translate well from stage to screen. And I'm so happy that this movie does translate well from stage to screen. The performances are grounded, they feel real, they feel authentic. But the music is lively, the music is lavish, it is incredibly cinematic. I saw this in theaters on a big screen, and that really, really made the experience that much more exhilarating for me. This movie was made to see on the big screen, but if you are a fan of Hamilton and Lin-Manuel Miranda and that kind of style of musical and storytelling, I think you'll really, really enjoy In the Heights. And in my number two spot, we have Cruella. Emma Stone becoming that much more of a Hollywood icon after this performance. And oh my God, Disney live action remakes are such a mixed bag these days. And I couldn't believe how much Disney got right by this one. I've seen the movie twice and it is absolutely fantastic. It's like Devil Wears Prada meets Joker. Disney did not shy away from going dark. Disney did not make Cruella de Vil a hero by the end of this. They really kept true to the juicy origins of what makes Cruella de Vil such a fun, villain, but adding necessary layers and backstory to make her that much more interesting as a person, Emma Stone did a phenomenal job. Cruella has become that much more of an iconic cinematic character to me because of this film. And in my number one spot, my favorite movie of the year so far is Supernova, starring Colin Firth and Stanley Tucci. And this is also going on my list of being one of my favorite LGBTQ films of all time. Now, this movie is heartbreaking. It is incredibly sad. It's a very tough sell when talking up this movie to people, because you do need to be emotionally prepared going into it. It basically tells a story of a gay couple. They've been together for many, many years, and one of them has been diagnosed with early stages of dementia, and that's played by Stanley Tucci's character, and how that affects a relationship of that many years. And the great thing about this movie is that they are an LGBTQ couple, but them being a gay couple in the movie is never ever once mentioned or discussed. It's never a plot device. I find it so refreshing when you can have LGBTQ characters on screen and not make the fact that they are LGBTQ a plot device. They're just there. They're existing. They're human beings, and they're a married couple, and they happen to be gay men on screen. But getting back to the plot, it's how are you coping with your partner being diagnosed with dementia and starting to lose bits and pieces of themselves, and then jump to the other side of being that person, feeling that you are losing bits and pieces of yourself. It is so incredibly gut-wrenching, heartbreaking. This movie is contained. It's not very long. You feel the love. You feel that impact of what something like that could do to you and your significant other if you were, God forbid, ever in that situation. But it's one of those sad movies that didn't feel depressing. The interactions, the conversations with people, the little arguments, the little endearing moments, it all felt so real. It just felt like people. It just felt like people in life, just being themselves, just being in the present. And there was simplicity there. And it's a beautiful testament to love, and especially to those, in long-term relationships, those with partners. This movie made such a beautiful, strong impact. As you can tell, I can't recommend it enough. And that is why Supernova is currently my favorite movie that I've seen all year so far. And those are my top 10 favorites of the year so far. We have a lot more movies to see as the year approaches, and it'll be interesting to see how many of these make the final list at the end of the year. But I'd be curious to hear, what are some of your favorite movies you've seen this year? Are any of them the same as mine? Feel free to just list them down below. Go to town. I'd love to hear from you. Be on the lookout for a separate video where I list my least favorite movies of the year so far. Thank you all again for tuning in. And until next time, I'm Ryan Bamey, signing off. Bye, everyone.